this video, I'm going to walk you through some tips on how to engage in a journal article critique. And so here's an example of a template that you might have for the assignment for a journal article critique. One of the things you'll note right away in the article summary, so it's asking you for independent variables and dependent variables within your study. So the article that we're going to use as an example here actually has been kind of a controversial article on power posing, but we're going to look through this article. And so first off, We're interested in the independent variables. What are the independent variables in the study? And a couple different places you'd probably be able to find it. One is just in the abstract. And as we look through here, it's talking about high power as opposed to low power, no nonverbal displays. So that looks like it would be the independent variable. Changes for both male and female participants, but trying to see if they actually use gender as one of the independent variables in the study. And oftentimes what I recommend for students to do is go to the end of the introduction and literature review. Here is usually where you'll see the hypothesis for it, and you'll see them talk about the independent and dependent variables. So independent variable right here, the type of power pose, and it's got two levels to it, either a high power pose or a low power pose. And then here you'll see the dependent variables. What is it saying it's going to affect? And the experience of elevated testosterone levels, decreased cortisol, increased feelings of power, and higher risk tolerance. So those four areas, the testosterone levels, cortisol levels, feelings of power, and risk tolerance, those would be the dependent variables within this particular study. Oh, and I should clarify, we remember when we looked through the abstract, we were wondering whether or not gender would have been an independent variable in this particular study. But when we looked at the hypothesis here, we remember all we found was for the type of power pose. So the only independent variable here is type of power pose, and we have two levels to that, high and low power poses. So you'd have your independent and dependent variables down. Then next in here, it talks about what are the basic results of the study. Honestly, for getting that information, maybe even just going up into the abstract is oftentimes a good place to be able to find that information. Right in here kind of highlights the main results from this particular study. Even if you just ended right there, pretty good piece summary of the results all the way here, that fits for the results of this particular study. And then the next one in terms of the article summary, what are the implication of the results? That's one that some of my colleagues have talked about that students sometimes have some difficulty with. And again, a couple different places to note for that. One, it might talk about it here in the abstract, and you'll notice it's talking about has powerful real world and actionable implications. Where you'd find those implications, at least of what the researcher is saying is the implications, you'll find those typically towards the end of the article in the discussion section. And so you definitely you start seeing it in here, what they're describing as the implications from the results of this study. By simply changing physical posture, blah, 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 increases, it could improve confidence, performance in situations such as interviewing for jobs, public speaking in public, and so forth. And kind of summarizing it here as this, it might be the fake it till you make it, it actually is a real thing. So that's what the researchers are saying are the implications for this particular study. We go down a little farther. So again, the discussion sections where you want to look for that information. In here, the critique For internal validity and construct, external validity and construct validity. For internal validity, we're, the main thing we're looking for here is, did random assignment take place? And we'll find that in the method section. If random assignment did occur, they would say that pretty quickly within a method section. And so here we see that right away. We're randomly assigned to high and low power poses. So that means, okay, we've got an experiment. We can feel pretty good about the internal validity of this study, the be able to make cause and effect statements from in this study. One of the things that one of my colleagues has noted, that oftentimes students, they see there's random assignment, but they say, oh, they still can't make cause and effect statements because of certain third variables. Just a reminder that if random assignment takes place, that means that the third variable should be equally distributed between the different groups that participants have been randomly assigned to. So usually third variables, it'd be unusual for third variables to be a problem. I'm not saying it can't take place, but it would be unusual for that, for there to be those kinds of confounds in a design. If it's a correlational design, then we say, yeah, you know, the internal validity is kind of a problem. It's harder to make cause and effect statements. And it's as simple as saying that. It doesn't mean that the everything should just be thrown out within the study. It just means making cause and effect statements is difficult to do because they didn't randomly assign them to conditions. What's next on here is the external validity. Here. And typically, actually, we find students do pretty well with this for the external validity. So you're going to look for things about who are the subjects, how generalizable would it be, those kinds of things. And remember, this is a critique. So in this particular study, this example, you notice they say 42 participants, 26 females and 16 males, but they don't really give us much other information about the participants in the study. That's what you're critiquing. You say, we don't have a lot of information. It's hard for us to know how generalizable these results are because they're not really telling us who the participants are. And also in this particular case, 42 is a pretty small sample size. And so that may hurt in terms of generalizability as well. So those are the types of things you look at for generalizability. Also, you know, read through the method section for how it is that they're having them, what the research setting looks like, and those types of things. You'll find that information in the method section. Construct validity is about manipulations and measures. And just by the way, the template that I have listed here, your template might have fewer questions in it, or it might have more questions in it. I'm just going to talk about some of the basic things that we have in all of our templates for critiquing a journal article. And so one would be about the manipulations. So, you know, so basically you're critiquing, do you think the manipulations were good manipulations? And here they're talking about the power poses. So the power poses was a manipulation, right? They either had them engage in high power poses or low power poses. And in here, they talk about how they pre-tested the power poses, and that people who were in high power poses indeed rated significantly higher on power than those who were in low power poses. And it was a significant difference between those two. So they pre-tested the manipulation ahead of time. That's an example of what it is that you might talk about related to the manipulations here. You might also talk about things of, did the manipulations kind of sensitize the participants to the study, those types of things. Those are other things to talk about. And again, that information you're going to find in this method section for that. The other piece is about the measures that end up being used within a study. And so that information, again, is in the method section too. And oftentimes, this is where students get confused related to the measures that are being used, because maybe sometimes the study didn't provide a lot of information about the reliability and the validity of the measures. Remember, this is a critique. If they didn't provide that information, that's what you're critiquing. You're saying, I don't know how reliable or valid this is because the researcher didn't really talk about that. So where would you find the reliability and validity or those types of things within Within the study, again, you would look in the method section and you look to see how it is, you know, what were they're going to talk about the different measures. They talk about the measures for risk taking and powerful feelings here. They describe what it is that they have them do. They don't necessarily talk so much here in terms of reliability and validity of each of those. The saliva collection and analysis, they provide far more details regarding that, and so you can look through that. Oftentimes they'll give you information about this is what other researchers have used, so that's something you can talk about. Okay, other researchers have used this particular measure, and it's been deemed by a number of researchers that this is a good measure, let's say, of cortisol, or a good measure of testosterone levels. So this is, again, the information, that's where it is that you would find that information. The big thing here for this as well is what we want you to do is say, in your estimation, do you think this is a good measure? So they have, as an example here, they have their measure for risk taking. And you'll notice they say after they finished posing, participants were presented with a gambling task. They were given $2 and told they could keep the money, which would be a safe bet, or roll a die and risk losing the $2 in a payoff of $4. And that's their measure of risk taking. And for you, you have to decide, okay, do I think that's a good measure of risk taking or not? And if you do, say why it is. And if not, you should say why you don't think it is. And do you think this is a good rate, just asking people to rate how powerful and in charge they felt on a 1 to 4 scale? Do you think that's a good measure of it? Maybe you do, maybe you don't. That's your decision to make related to that. But we want you to take a little bit of time to think through that as measures. For this study, in terms of cortisol level and testosterone levels, I think most of us would say, okay, and those kind of levels are pretty difficult for participants to fake. That seems to be a pretty good measure within this particular study. Now, because this article doesn't provide information that we normally expect to see, that we often see within a journal article, I'm going to pull in one other article here quick to just give you an example. So we're not going to go through the full details of the article at all. But for this article, they're looking at psychological well-being and dynamics of life satisfaction. So let's go down to the measures here and see how they're measuring the variables in their study. And you'll notice one of them, they're using the NEO 5-factor inventory. They give you some examples of some of the items. You know, so for extroversion, this is an item that's measuring extroversion. So you can look at that in terms of at least its face validity to say, okay, yeah, that seems like the kind of question you would ask to measure extroversion. And then down here, what's called Cronbach Alphas. And Cronbach Alpha is a measure of internal consistency or internal reliability. So this is information about the reliability of the scale. And for each one of these, the rule of thumb or the heuristic that you would use for this is if the Cronbach Alpha is 0.70 or higher, that we consider that to be a pretty reliable scale. It's not going to get any higher than 1.0. So when we see internal consistencies like this, we think, okay, that's good evidence that this is a pretty reliable scale. But you'll notice it doesn't really give us any information about the validity of the scale. The information you expect for validity is that it correlated with other measures of personality, or that, even better, it predicted certain behavior in the real world. And you'll notice we don't find any of that information. They're not providing that. And the other measures, they have measures of life satisfaction. With the life satisfaction scale, you'll notice they talk about it as a 5-item self-report. They give you an example of the item as well. And the psychological, then over here, the scales of psychological well-being they provide. And again, they tell you that it's 42 items. They give you some sample questions off of this as well. So again, you can look at the face validity. You can at least talk about that for the scale that, okay, these items do seem to be getting at psychological well-being. And then you'll notice down here, they provide the Cronbach Alphas for this. So they're providing reliability information. The Cronbach Alphas here, we would say, okay, that it seems to have good internal consistency or good reliability. What they're not providing, again, they're not providing us information about the validity of the scale. Does it predict behavior in the future? Does it predict other types of things like depression and that type of thing? They don't provide that information within here. And so you just say that in your critique. You say there wasn't much information about the validity. It seemed to have good reliability, but they're not providing much about the validity of this particular scale. And then as we'll go through for the conclusions, you're to talk about the ethics. So you think through this study, and does there seem to be some potential ethical problems? And then just again, overall, going back to the implications. So they're saying the implications of this study say, hey, maybe simply engaging in high power poses might help you to become a more confident individual in your everyday life. Do you agree with that or not? Or do you think that they're taking too much of a leap here for what's presented within these data? Those are the types of things that we want you to think about. And the areas where you're going to find that, again, particularly related to implications, is usually right towards the end of the discussion section here. So I hope this video helps you with your journal article critiques.